Ryan Songalia of Rappler.com, coming to you from Makati Cinema Square in Makati City, Philippines. And we're up to our main event of the night between Drian Francisco and Mateo Handig. Filipino versus Filipino. So we have the former interim WBA junior bantamweight champion, Drian Francisco, making his way to the ring right now. The pride of Sablayan Mindoro. Benton Kamo against the Warrior. The Wadai Warrior. Mateo Handig of Katarman, Northern Samar. So the multi-talented ring announcer also sings the national anthem. First time I've ever seen that in professional boxing. Final instructions, and we're underway now in a matter of seconds. Drian Francisco versus Mateo Handig. And you wonder now if this is going to be a physical mismatch, because Drian has fought most of his career at 115, 118, 122 pounds. Handig was weighing just 110 pounds in his last fight in September. His best weight was probably at 105 pounds, which is where he fought when he defeated the multiple-time champion from Japan, Katsunori Takayama, back in 2012 to become the number one ranked contender by the IBF. Back in 2012 in La Trinidad Banguet. But Handig hasn't won a fight since then. And you may notice across his chest, it may be hard actually to see, Handig has, I would say, the worst tattoo of any I've ever seen on a boxer. It says across his chest, champion IBF eliminator. Eliminator is misspelled, it appears. And you're not really the champion if you just want an eliminator. You can be in position to fight for a championship. But, you know, tattoos are like diamonds. They're forever. Handig doesn't have any other tattoos, so I guess he learned his lesson there. As Drian drives his opponent across the ring with a right hand. Francisco is fighting for the first time since November of 2015, when he lost a unanimous decision to pound-for-pound elite Guillermo Rigondo. And that was in Las Vegas on the undercard of Canelo Alvarez against Miguel Cotto. And you would think, you know, because Rigondo had been a good fighter at a higher weight and had reached higher limits or higher levels than Francisco, that it would be a relatively easy fight for Rigondo. But Rigondo didn't really push the action, squandered an opportunity to really stamp himself as an exciting fighter with a guy who he probably could have excelled against. And Drian Francisco capitalizes the first round with a few heavy punches. And he probably won that first round. But looking at Drian Francisco's background, he has been a professional since 2005. Before that, he got a business administration degree from San Sebastian College in Sablayan, Mindoro. So he's an educated guy. Knows what he's talking about on and off the ring. And in 2010, he won the interim WBA 115-pound title. Never won the full title. Knocked out a fighter named Duong Pech Kokyejim in 10 rounds in Thailand. But lost his next fight in 2011. And was based in the U.S. for a while. Won a fight over there and lost to Chris Avalos. So he's been trying to get back to that same level. He was sidetracked in 2015 with a first round knockout loss against Jason Canoy at Legao Gym in General Santos City. Drian says he was sick before that fight. But we'll see if that's an anomaly or a sign of some vulnerability still in him. He's no spring chicken. He's 34 years old now. Trying to get something going for himself in the 122-pound division. Nice shots right there by Francisco to the head and body. Handig's a southpaw in the yellow trunks, the red and white is Drian Francisco. From Samar on the back of Handig's trunks as Francisco lands a right hand to the front of Handig's trunks. And Handig is, I think, feeling the strength advantage of Francisco. And he definitely felt that straight right hand right to the guard, and the right uppercut that came along. And this is, I think, devolving into what I was concerned about, the physical mismatch of having Handig, who has not been on the winning side of fights in recent years, and who is a naturally smaller fighter, and Drian Francisco, who has gone rounds with some big fighters. So this fight was actually scheduled for a catch weight of 124 pounds. And Francisco is now based out of Imus Cavite. He's trained, managed by Jovan Jimenez, who is also promoting tonight's show. As Handig tries to scoot over to the side and get a left-handed. That's the end of the second round. Drian is in full control. Not a big surprise there. Gather anything from that second round, it does appear that Handig is feeling the strength advantage of Francisco, and his confidence must not be too high, given that he's lost his last seven fights, and he's not necessarily been fighting at the highest level, and at least in the last few fights. All losses against modest opposition here in the Philippines. Oh, that was a nice jab by Francisco that knocks Handig's face back. I mean, the head also comes with the face, but he knocked everything back on that shot. And Francisco is basically just controlling the pace right now. Handig doesn't really want to lead, doesn't want to expose himself, and Francisco takes the invitation to hit him with three punches. That was a partially blocked right hand that sends Handig across the ring. And if you're wondering how many times Handig has been stopped in his 12 defeats, he's been stopped three times. He was stopped in 2015 by Ben Mananquil. Earlier that year by Boonsam Lamsiri. And then in the fight before that, in 2014, he was stopped by Nawafon Kaikana in Thailand as well. So Handig is an egg that has been cracked before. And we'll see if Drian can re-scramble those eggs tonight. As we see Handig trying to use some fancy footwork to slip in a straight left hand there. You know, we mentioned earlier that Francisco has a college degree. He is a smart boxer. He is a smart person. You can see, even as he's popping that jab, he's thinking of what he's going to do next. He's analyzing. He's like a computer. He pushes a key and goes to see what the data is that he collected from that, and he lands a four-punch combination, and now he's having some fun with some people at ringside. Nice move to step over to the side and land a couple of right hands. So Drian has educated mind and educated feet, as we see his footwork setting up different punches. And that's the end of the third round. Drian Francisco in control through three rounds. He's smiling, he's laughing, he's having a good time, and that's kind of in line with his personality. Drian is a carefree, engaging, humorous person. And he's finding some humor in the way he's engaging Mateo Handig so far. Francisco trying to get back into the title picture. I think he has to shake off some rust, but I think also importantly, he needs to do something that will get some attention for himself, particularly from fighters abroad. It's one thing to come back from over a year out of the ring and get a win, but people look at the box rec and they see that you went the distance with a fighter who was 13-12, and his best fights were at lower weights. Doesn't really look that great. But Drian is having his way with Handig. He's looking away, he's landing punches, jumping in, stepping away. Look at that, he was almost backwards. He almost turned his back and is still able to stick a left jab between Handig's guard. And there's a right hand. And Handig can't really get anything going for himself there. And then even when he gets through, he's not particularly a big puncher. He's more of an accumulation type of fighter. He tries to wear guys down with pressure and out-hustle them. We haven't seen any of that so far tonight from Mateo Handig. You know, that was very, very interesting by Drian Francisco. Blows his nose and stamps it out. I guess so that it doesn't stick to anyone's shoe tonight when people inevitably flood the ring after the show. Drian seems to be having a lot of fun. He's laughing at an inside joke that maybe no one else here in the arena are privy to. Maybe after the fight I'll ask him what was so funny. Maybe he's laughing at Mateo Handig's tattoo. It's gotta be distracting for a fighter, you know. Especially if you're really big on grammar and spelling. You see a typo in a guy's tattoo and you're staring at his chest, it's going to be, you know, it could take you by surprise when Handig starts throwing some punches at you. That was acrobatic, reminiscent almost of Emmanuel Augustus, the dancing fighter. He leapt halfway across the ring to throw a jab, which is one way, I guess, to cut or close the distance. This has been a mismatch so far. So we're halfway home. Drian Francisco lands a straight right hand, and we have country music for some reason in Manila. And we have boxing in Makati, where former WBA interim junior bantamweight title holder Drian Francisco is having a lap at Mateo Handig's expense through four rounds of boxing. Getting the second half of the fight, round number five about to start. Drian Francisco in the red and white, the guy who's landing punches, and Mateo Handig in the yellow, and I guess that's like a royal blue. He's the guy who's taking punches. Let's see if see what Francisco has up his sleeve. Will he do a backflip while simultaneously throwing a double jab? The 122-pound division hasn't had much change in the recent years. It's still Guillermo Rigondeaux at the top. And then you have Jesse Magdaleno, the WBO champion, who won the title with a decision win over Nonito Donaire. You have the IBF champion, Yukinori Oguni. So there is some talent. There is a lack of star power. Of course, there's still Genesis Cervania, who's a Filipino, formerly of the Ala Boxing Stable, now fighting out of Japan. And we have Drian and Mateo Handig gauging in a sweaty hug, and now they're back to punching each other. They trade uppercuts. And Mateo Handig had visions of landing an uppercut there, and that didn't come true for him. And but Drian was able to get through with a straight right hand. There's three straight right hands from Handig. It was a right hook to the body, a right uppercut, and then a right hook upstairs. And Handig is also laughing now, I guess getting punched in the back of the head is something to find humorous. But you'd want to see something out of Francisco. And I think he was trying to get something there with that right hand. That was a home run right hand that caught some of the guard of Handig. Handig had his chin tucked in. And then Drian cracks right through with a right hand. And Handig pushes a couple of left hands up the middle, which didn't really have much power, but I guess it could help to get your confidence up, just knowing that you're putting some gloves on your opponent. So there's the fifth round. Drian isn't laughing as much right now. I think he's a bit, bored or... But he just seemed a bit more passive in the fifth round there. We want to thank all of the viewers who are tuning in from around the world on Rappler. And if Drian wanted to get the attention of some of these names in the 122-pound division, a great way to do so would be to score a knockout. And we'll see if that's in the cards for Drian or not. Handig doesn't seem to be going anywhere just yet. Round number six begins for Drian Francisco and Mateo Handig, and we wonder what round six will bring us. That's Francisco in the red and white, and Mateo Handig landing a straight left hand and a couple right hooks in the yellow and royal blue. Francisco, as we noted earlier, the bigger man, bigger punch. Handig is the Wadai warrior from Katarman, Northern Samar. Nice to see some fighters from the Eastern Versailles region. There was some boxing out there. Of course, there's Manny Pacquiao's father is actually from that area. And then from Ormoc City is the former junior flyweight and flyweight champion, John Real Casimiro, who's going to be plying his trade in the 115-pound division. He'll soon make his debut in that weight class. But you can just look at the two, even as Francisco misses punches, you can see that these are two fighters in different weight classes. And whenever Francisco even partially lands, you can see the impact that it has on Handig. It knocks him back. And Francisco is chasing his opponent down right now. Lands a jab over the top as Handig was trying to escape. There's a nice left hook just to kind of keep Handig in front of him, and then he throws a right hand. Oh, that was a nice right hand by Francisco. Probably the best punch of the fight. Handig goes to the ropes. Let's see if Francisco is... Drian's looking at me because I'm talking too loud. Because the crowd is not making much noise. Drian gave me a look like, yeah, I know what I'm doing here. Let's keep our voices down so we don't disrupt Drian Francisco's confidence as he goes through what appears to be a six shutout round so far against Mateo Handig. I wonder how that is for a fighter, particularly in a venue that isn't packed and there isn't a whole lot of noise being made. You must hear the commentators, and the fighter must think, hey, why is this guy annotating exactly what I just done? Or narrating my every move. The seventh round coming up, we're in the process of the seventh round, and Drian Francisco, hands down at his side, looking for an opening, hoping to draw a counter punch opportunity from Handig, and then he just decides, hey, you know what, I'm just going to take some swings at Handig and see what sticks. Drian showing some pretty good ring generalship. He's been able to keep his left foot outside of the right foot of Handig, which is what you want to do when you're fighting against a southpaw. so that you can get over to the left and make the southpaw reach with his left hand, which is typically the power punch for a southpaw. Although I can tell you a few guys who have pretty good right hooks, like Chad Dawson, southpaw, as a his primary weapon would be a right hook. Michael Moore, who was the former heavyweight champion, his money punch, to the degree that he did have one at the heavyweight level, was a right hook, I would say. But Francisco is in total control right now. It's not the most competitive of fights yet. And there, Francisco just is able to stick that left hand in, almost as if like as a power shot. That jab is almost like a power shot, the way he throws it. Like right there, that's a power shot. That's like getting stuck in the face with a telephone pole. That's a power shot by Handig, a right uppercut that lifts Drian Francisco's chin up, and a left hand right behind it by Handig. And Handig is having his best success so far of the fight, landing a couple punches. And keeping Francisco on the back foot here. You have to wonder, though, if Handig was a junior featherweight, a real junior featherweight, would those punches have more impact? And Francisco is back in the driver's seat right now. Sticks a right hand in Handig's mouth, and there's the end of the seventh round, and we have 3 more minutes of action. So, unless something out of the ordinary, out of the far down on the totem pole of possibilities occurs, Drian Francisco should be walking away with a unanimous decision win here. And in some respects, this may actually be the kind of performance that emboldens opponents, because they say, hey, he's coming off of a fight, off of a win, and it wasn't exactly a scintillating performance. It was in its own way, dominant, but it wasn't something that would scare guys away, I would say. Although you have to wonder, maybe a bit of it is Drian Francisco wiping off some of the ring rust that he may be experiencing. Pretty rowdy crowd tonight. That's sarcasm. It's been a pretty docile crowd tonight. We had one upset earlier where Jofer Montano suffered the first defeat of his professional career. It's been a professional fight. Both guys fighting clean and showing their own skill and ability. There have been no knockdowns. Neither guy has been seriously hurt. Drian has been in control for the most part. But he's content to box also. He is a strong puncher, but it's not in his nature to go out there and try to destroy a guy. This has been a sound, credible exhibitions of athleticism under the rubric of professional boxing. And I think that everyone can go home with a smile on their face if they're a boxing fan, because they're getting to see one of the more popular fighters from the Philippines in recent years. Obviously, on a lower rung than Nonito Donaire, Manny Pacquiao, even someone like Donnie Nietes and Brian Valoria. But a fighter who is beloved by many in Philippine boxing, Drian Francisco. You're getting to see him get a win against a tough guy who rightfully so carries the nickname the Wadai Warrior. Mateo Handig, who is against the ropes right now, and he takes a right hand and kind of deflects the left hook that came from behind. They came behind him. And that's the final bell, and I think it's, that may have been an 80-72 performance, or that could be 79-73. Oh wait, actually no, this is a 10 round. My apologies, this is a 10 round bout. We're not yet done. Actually, yes, this is a 10-round fight. The fight before this was the 8-round fight. So here we go. We're in the 9th round. We have 2 more rounds of boxing. 6 more minutes of action. Coming to you from the... from Makati Cinema Square. Drian is working off of his feints now, setting up a nice right hand and a left hook to the body right behind it. The advantage of fighting 10 rounds is that it looks better on BoxRec, particularly if you have a name and people may be shopping around for a credible opponent. It looks better if you won a 10-round fight rather than an 8-round fight. Oh, that was a nice trap that Francisco had set with that straight left hand. We have Francisco just patting him around the ears, trying to see what kind of opening he can knock open. Oh, that was a nice right hand, right up the middle. And you can see, even though Drian Francisco is probably in the twilight of his career, he still is in pretty good shape. He has good reflexes, and he knows how to place his punches. He's not a shot fighter. And you have to wonder if the time off actually may have given him a bit of space to recharge his batteries, rather than the constant build-up of a training camp and then the hundreds of rounds a guy might spar over a year. Francisco Francisco still looks like a fresh fighter. And there's nothing fresh about those right hands there that Handig just absorbed. There we go. The ring announcer's microphone is working again. Looking into the corner of Handig, you have to wonder, will he sell out to try and get a victory? My suspicion is that Handig will go through the motions for another 3 minutes, not do anything that would get him hurt against Drian Francisco. The ring announcer, this is the 10th round. This is the 10th and final round. Handig is fainting like he wants to set something up, but all that setup was him getting punched in the face with a right hand. Handig tries it again, and that can be the danger sometimes when you faint and then you don't do anything. The fighter who is the faintee will then say, okay, well, here's my opportunity. I'm going to take a swing. And that's what Francisco was doing there. And as if to underscore just how much in charge he is. Oh, that was a power left jab. Those left jabs have been some of the hardest punches that Drian has landed, and they've been some of the straightest punches that he's landed. Because, oh, that was a nasty headbutt to Handig's face. I don't believe there's any blood. It would be a great misfortune if these two fighters had gotten to this point, and then only in the final round did a cut occur. Because that's when fighters are looking at layoffs. They have to look at the cut heal and medical suspensions. And Francisco is really beating up Handig right here. Like, he's manhandling the smaller fighter here in the 10th round. And And Handig has just been outmanned. Like, he's been outskilled, but he's also been out-physicaled by Drian Francisco, who is the larger man. That's the reality. Handig got off with a couple punches early on. He was landing with straight lefts and doubling up with his right hooks. But he just hasn't been able to really put any kind of hurt on Drian Francisco. And Mateo Handig's face is starting to show the damage. It's been showing the damage for a couple rounds. He's red around the face, some swelling. And every time Drian lands a punch against his head, against his gloves, Handig's head's been flying back. His body's been moving back. And that's the final bell. So what did we see in those two extra rounds that I had not accounted for? More of the same stuff we saw in the previous 8. Hey, Drian, am I still talking too loud? As we await the scorecards, I guess now with the music, Drian can't hear me. But this has been a rush-shedding performance for Drian, as he was able to show some of his movement. He was able to show up for the crowd. He showed some power. He showed some boxing. Showed a little bit of everything. So you got to see what happens for him now. Will he get ranked after this fight? Or will he have to fight someone else to get ranked? It's hard to get those big fights when you're not ranked. So we'll have to see some see what kind of politicking Francisco's camp can do with the sanctioning bodies to determine just what comes next for Drian Francisco. But as we've seen, he has still has some fight left in him, and we await the scorecards. Comeback is real for Drian Francisco as he wins his first fight back after over 1 year out of the ring. He wins a 10-round unanimous decision against a game but outgunned Mateo Handig. For Rappler.com, I'm Ryan Tsongalia. Thank you very much for tuning in to tonight's fights.